Chapter 4, verse 6 to 8. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Paul, a pattern of a successful minister. Paul, a pattern, a model, worthy of emulation, an example, a mentor to look up to. Paul, a pattern of a successful minister. This scripture sums up the end of Paul's life. Now, if you read about Samson, somewhere before Samson died, we will get to that. We'll get to that tomorrow. But here, these two, three scriptures. Paul, a pattern of a successful minister. Now, how do you define success, by the way? Especially in ministry. And the yardstick to measure success is not after the custom and the tradition of the world. Because if you look around your neighborhood, if you look around in even your own church, in your own ministry, and you see people live their lives, you see people minister here and there, you are tempted to say that man is a successful minister, and yet he's still under probation. He hasn't got to the pearly gate of heaven yet. He hasn't reached the finishing line. He has not come to this point where Paul will say, for the time of my departure, for I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. How many people can say this? Like Paul the apostle, and say, I have kept the faith. In these days that people lose their mind, where money has taken over the central stage on the pulpit, where money determines who preaches the gospel, who does not preach the gospel, where money determines who it makes up to the board of trustees and council of the church or not, where money now gives the anointing, where money now takes the central stage in ministry, that everything now is built around money, Everything now is built around he's a successful man in every respect. And what is success? Because he has the mundane things of his life. But here now we have a man, a champion, who has run this race successfully to the very end. And he's telling us that I am now ready to be offered. And the time of my departure is at hand. Now you need to know the pedigree of this man. Look at in verse 5. He said, but watch thou in all things. That's a successful person. He's watching around him. Watch thou in all things. Don't major in some things and minor in some things. Don't build your life around the physical, temporal success that people pursue today. Don't build your life around things that does not count in time and eternity. But here Paul said, for I am now ready. He said, watch thou in all things. Endure affliction. Do the work of an evangelist. Make full proof of thy ministry. And then he said, for now I am now ready to be offered. And the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course and I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but also unto them that also the love is appearing. What are we saying? A man that has got to this level, you need to watch his life. No wonder in Timothy, this same 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 10, he was talking to Timothy, a son in the faith. At this time, Paul was around 65 to 70 years of age. And Timothy was just clocking 30, 35. And sometimes, somewhere, he said, Paul the aged. And he was talking to this young man who he has put in the church at Ephesus. He has also another son in the Lord, who he has put in the church at Crete. That's Titus. And he was writing these epistles to them. And he wrote and said, verse 10 of 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 10, he said, but thou hast fully known my doctrine, my manner of life, my purpose, my faith, my long suffering, my charity, my patience, my persecutions, my afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra. What persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But evil men shall and seducers shall worse, worse and worse. Isn't that what is happening? Look up here. Isn't this what is happening? Certain things I wouldn't like to talk about them, but sometimes compared to talk about them. That seducers are worsening worse and worse, deceiving the church, misleading the church, derailing the church, deluding the church. Seducers by way of prophecies. Seducers by way of revelations. Seducers, they are worsening worse and worse. When they do certain things, you say, wow, which other worse thing can they do? Just wait for the next 2-3 weeks. Just wait. Just wait. And we hear them say, Jesus said, Makesambo has bribed somebody to post so stories. Makesambo, Jesus said, Makesambo bribed somebody. Jesus said, Makesambo bribed somebody. Somebody I've never seen, somebody I've never known. I bribed somebody to sponsor story on you on the internet. I'm telling you that seducers are worse, worse, and worse. Seducers, deceiving people and being deceived. But watch thou in all things. Endure affliction. Do the work. Forget those criticisms. Put them behind you. Do the work. See, I've come to the point where that praise or criticism mean nothing to me anymore. Praise or criticism. When you get to the point, the Lord has to talk to me about this in the last 3 weeks. My son, come up to the point where criticism or praise means nothing to you. I'm dead to the world and all his idols to flee. Do the work. Help me do the work. Don't bring bad news to me. The bad news don't inspire. They don't encourage. They are poison. Do the work. Paul was talking to his son in the faith. He said, but thou hast fully known my doctrine. Can somebody come to you, having known me, here on this pulpit for the past 3 years, and I've been consistent on this. Can somebody come to you now and tell you that Jesus said, Michael Sambo, pay somebody money, bribe somebody to sponsor story on internet, and you will agree? Come. And you agree? But thou hast fully known my doctrine, my manner of life, my purpose, my faith, long suffering, charity, patience. What have not, what, tell me what I've not endured. Patience. Tell me what. What again? Persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch and Iconium, at Lystra. What persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. Yea. And all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Kai, why do you hate man like this? What offense have these people coming to you, offense committed against you, that you will use this prophecy, these dreams, these lies, deceive them? Delude them, causing them to believe a lie. But evil men shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. Knowing of whom thou hast learned them. So Paul was writing to Timothy, to Titus, and to us, watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. I have kept the faith. I am saying, we are in the time people lose faith. People are losing their faith. People are losing their mind. They no longer have a mind of their own. They're giving over to wishy-washy gospel. A gospel that doesn't have conviction and weight on it. A gospel that produces fake people. Counterfeit people. False people. Gospel without conviction. Gospel without godliness in it. Gospel full of greed. Gospel
gospel of covetousness, gospel with the substance of the word, wishy-washy gospel, adulterated gospel, fake gospel, fake people. I have kept the faith. I have kept the faith. I kept it. I treasure it. I lay hold on eternal life. I will not let it go. My righteousness I hold fast. Timothy, you know me. You know, if nobody else knows me, you know. When I travel with you to a crusade, I don't sneak out in the night to another place. You know me. When I'm counseling the women, you know how I counsel them. You know I don't close the door of my hotel room when I counsel women. You know that. Timothy, even though demons departed and went after the pattern and the manner and the custom of the world, but you kept faith with me. You stood with me in my persecution, in my affliction, in my trouble. You stay with me. You know my manner of life. And now I am ready to be offered. The time of my departure is at hand. I have finished the good fight. Oh, glory to the Lord. I've kept the faith. I finished my course. Paul was writing. He was a man of like passion as we are. He spent the earlier part of his life in religion without righteousness. He exhibits zeal without knowledge until the light of God shone on him. On the way to Damascus, and from then to the end of his life, that encounter Paul had changed him. He changed his theology. He changed his philosophy. He changed everything. His integrity was changed. Radical change. No amount of beating could stop Paul. No amount of suffering could stop Paul. Hunger could not stop him. False brethren could not force him. Travails in the sea, travails among false brethren, travails in everything he suffered, beating, hunger, thirst, had everything, suffering, persecution, affliction, could not stop him. From the very first day he got encounter with Jesus, Paul began to run the race, the Christian life. He ran the ministerial race until now he could look up to heaven. He could look up to the women he counseled. He could look up to the ladies. He could look up. He told Timothy, Timothy, I'm telling you, when the women come to you, treat the sisters, treat the young ladies as what? As sisters. With all purity. He ran the race until now he looked back in Damascus. He looked at Jerusalem. He looked at Ethiopia. He looked at there and said, I'm not ready to be offered. I'm ready to go. No skeleton in my cupboard. He exhibited zeal with that knowledge until the lights of God shone on him on the way to Damascus, and from there to the end of his life he served God with an unabating zeal. The passion, the energy, the enthusiasm, the power, the focus, the purpose-driven life. He stood firm on the gospel. And the hope of man is only on the gospel. So he did not swerve to the left. He did not swerve to the right. He stayed on course. Permit me to say, from the beginning, that God required no less surrender or consecration from those who wish to serve him. When God calls you, put your eggs in God's basket. No plan B. Because God is the rewarder of those who diligently seek him. You are playing pranks because you are not seeking God diligently. But if you are seeking God diligently, no plan B. God
not less.
He requires no less. Surrender or consecration.
Jesus did not make the terms of discipleship more attractive. No. He told them, you must lose your life in mine. If you don't take up your cross and follow me,
forget.
You cannot. Jesus spoke with affirmation. You cannot be my disciple. So, Jesus did not make the terms of discipleship more attractive in order to gain more followers, but rather, in a very straightforward manner, he demanded the following, and listen to them. One, supreme love for him. Supreme love for him. Luke 14:26. God demands supreme love. They say there is a supreme court in Nigeria. That's the highest court of the land. You just get the supreme court, you lose it. Report it to God. No other place. And so God demands supreme love. Luke 14:26. If any man come to me, Jesus is not forcing you, but when you come, and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot. You can only pretend and deceive yourself. You cannot deceive God. You cannot. Supreme. This love, unreserved love that God demands from you, place it above father. Place it above mother. When there's a conflict between God and your father, go for God. When there's conflict between the love God demands from you and that of your wife, go for God. When there's a conflict between the love that God demands from you and your own very life, drop your own life for God. Number two, denial of self. Denial of self. God demands the terms of discipleship. He don't demand less than denial of self. Matthew 16:24. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself. One, take up his cross. Two, follow me. He demands no less than this. Number three, a deliberate choosing of the cross. Take up your own cross. Jesus demonstrated that physically on the Passion time, Passion week, on his way to be crucified. He took his own cross, that wooden image that is half cross on it. Now it's not that no more that wooden thing. It is spiritual. That suffering that you could avoid, put your neck in the yoke. Take it. Choose it. Don't run away from it. Because a soldier that runs away from battle leaves to fight another. Face it. Your cross. And everybody must take up his cross. This is the race for everyone. Take up your cross. A deliberate choosing of your cross. Number the next one, a life spent in following him. A life spent in following him. You must follow Christ and spend your entire life. It is a Christian vocation. Vocation. A vocation in sickness, in health. I was in Jalibu. My wife had traveled. So many things my wife doesn't hear them. And she's hearing what this one is hearing. But when I traveled, I felt so sick. In the heat of the matter at that time, I felt so sick that I could not stand up from my bed. Could not. I could not shake myself to even make an attempt to stand up. I was just panting and grunting in the room. Suddenly, God sent me help. A brother from Wakara traveled to Ghana, a friend of mine, and I got to my house. My sitting room door was opened. He came in and sat down. And started talking. Nobody was responding. He now kept knocking. Because he's a very good friend, close friend of mine, he just attempted to check the other visitors. Then he quickly had me shaking my leg on the bed. He now came and saw me in a very, very bad state. Quickly, he knew my other friend, who is a neighbor and a medical doctor. He quickly called him and said, please come out. And that one man came. And then I just ran out to the pharmacy and bought drugs and bought drinks and masala, dextrose, and even set up the life of him. And then I was recovering. While I slept off, God gave me a revelation. Because I was like, God, can't you take my life? Look at the trouble, the affliction I am passing through in the ministry here, and then look at health issue, and then my organic was told that my disciple is sick, he's within me. Satan is the one, Satan, you will be sick, never come out of me. Oh, doctor, I said. I was not surrounded by love at all. My conversation on phone are monitored, and my talks with people are monitored, and then I'm sitting down here, people are monitoring me. No freedom. That was the kind of scenario I found myself. And then, while I was in that trance, the Lord came to me and said, let me show you how Lazarus was, and showed me the revelation of Lazarus with his wounds. Hey, Jesus. He said, that man you saw, that was Lazarus. And he said, if Lazarus went through this and kept faith with me, and he said, hey, no matter what you pass, you can never be an excuse. He came back from that truth. It was clear. I saw that Lazarus. He said, see Lazarus. Wounds. Pus. Oozing out. Blood mixed. Think of the unthinkable. Think of it. A life spent following Christ all the way in suffering, in joy, in sickness, in health, in poverty, in wealth, joy in all circumstances. You are joyful following Christ. Examine yourself in your walk with God in the past few years. Did you truly follow Christ? Check out. A fervent love for all who love the Lord. Why do you hate people that love the Lord? Who are your best friends? Why do you love people that hate the Lord? People that hate the Lord. People that love the doctrine of Balaam and the Nicolaitans. People that love the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. People that love Balak and Balaam. People that are fighting against the Lord people. Are the people you love? I'm talking about a fervent love for all who love him. And unswerving continuance in his word. Unswerving continuance. That today, tomorrow, you don't swerve. This is the way you swerve off. You derail. You are on the rail. Then you derail. you go off the rail, you take another rail, you derail. You go off. You go off from the rail. The train is on the rail, you derail. You go off the rail. You're no more on the rail. You're no more following the Lord. You're no more following. You don't. An unswerving continuance in the world. And then we have a forsaking all to follow him. I forsake all to follow the Lord. I forsake everything. I forsake my ambition. I forsake my aspiration. I forsake everything. I forsake the worldly attire. I forsake the worldliness. I forsake worldly association. I forsake everything that is of the world. Abraham, leave your father, leave your mother, leave your land of nativity, leave your people, leave your idol, leave your place. Come, I will show you a land flowing with milk and honey, a land of Canaan, a land I will share show you. And Abraham left everything. He forsook all. He forsook all. He left everything. He forsook everything. Everything. He left all. I don't know how to define all. All is defined as all. Any other definition? No. All is what? All. You left everything. All the losses of the past, you left them. All the marriages of the world, you left them. All the attire of the world, you left them. All the things that are of the world, you left them. The love of the Father is not in him. For all that love the world, the love of the Father, the loss of the eye, the pride of life, they are not of the Father, but of the world. And the world passeth away, and the fashion thereof. But he that abideth in the will of God, abideth forevermore. You leave the friendship with the world, the enmity with the world. You leave all those worldly things, all those marriages, how they do marriage in the world. And for the single sisters who are here, who say, I've had a sister say, she's not even a sister, a Christian lady, not even a Christian lady, a lady. Say, I will marry, whether the man come from God or Satan, I will marry him. A forsaking of all. A forsaking of all. The things that are of the world, you forsake them. How they do marriages in the world, you forsake it. How they do burials in the world, you forsake it. How they do ceremonies in the world, you forsake it. How they do their dressing, the pattern of the world, the systems of the world, sophisticated systems of the world, you forsake everything. A forsaking of all to follow Christ. A forsaking of all, and you keep following Christ. You forsake everything. Everything is everything. Everything is everything. You forsake everything. Follow him. Paul was a man who truly fulfilled these terms. Three things we're going to look at. Number one, the call of Paul. Paul's call. Number two, Paul's commission. Number three, Paul's consecration. This is the direction this conference is going. We're talking about the call of God. The call of God. We're talking about commitment. We're talking about consecration. We're talking about the call of God. Commitment, consecration. God wants you to come up higher. Your consecration is not enough. What actually you thought was consecration was rubbish. Was not consecration. What you thought was consecration was not. It happened to be not. Now God is calling you to a higher life. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Lead me to that rock. That level. Higher level of higher life. High level. Deep. Deeper than the ocean. Deeper. 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 That's what God is calling you. You have a dream in life. There's a purpose where you're created. And it's not an empty dream. You were born for such a time like this. Thank God. Praise God. You are privileged to be called of God. And to be positioned where God will see you and locate you and use you and bring glory to his name. And bring sons and daughters to glory. And bring people to the knowledge of the truth. People to the knowledge of the Lord. Thank God you are in that position today where God is depending on you. Thank God you are in that position today where God is looking up to you to avail yourself, to bring your vessels, not a few, because he's going to fill you to overflowing. He's crying out. The Spirit of God is in the womb, in the maternity, trying to give back to people that will receive the anointing of God, that will receive the power of God, that will get the message, the prophetic anointing, the anointing, the prophetic apostolic anointing, that will go to places where people have tried and have failed and they will succeed there. And that anointing is coming upon you tonight. I said that power is coming upon you tonight. The way people went and did not succeed, and they ran away because they said the ground is hard. That even this place there where Satan's seat is, God is sending you with a message of hope, with a message of deliverance, with a message of righteousness. You are going to rise up. You are going to get up with anointing and power. That nation is waiting for you. That community is waiting for you. Those people are waiting. The children are waiting for you. The youth are waiting for you. And that anointing is coming upon you tonight. I say it is coming upon you tonight. You are rising up from this company. You are going back with the anointing and the power of God. And wherever Satan is, you are going to bulldoze him out. In that community, as you go with the power of God, whatever power of the devil that is standing against the work of God in that community, you are going back with anointing. You are going back with power. You are going back with authority. You will put the devil out of that place. I say you will put the devil out of that place. The power of God and anointing is coming upon you. As he came upon Paul, the apostle is coming upon you. As he came upon Timothy, young minister, is coming upon you. As he came upon Esther, is coming upon you. Esther could change the course of the parlor because the hand of God was upon her. The anointing of God was upon her. What am I saying? That Paul, God called Paul, and God put anointing on him. God put his power. The Bible said, behold, he prayed. He prayed.
Have you seen?
And so the call of Paul, very important. From the day he encountered Christ, his life changed. Yes, Jesus changed me. Jesus touched me. My life changed. Yes, Jesus touched me. My life changed. I am glad and I've decided to keep following every day. And he touched me and my life had changed. That was the day I gave my life to Christ. Evangelist Philip Magazine came to my village, 1993, youth conference, preached that Saturday morning. From the singing of this song, my life changed. When he made that call, I was the one in the front. I ran and I gave my life to Jesus. I said, from today, I will follow the Lord. From today, I give you my life. I give you my all. Even though I didn't know what I was saying at that time. But that call came since that day. And I kept following through until today. And I've not looked red. I've not looked black. I've not looked back. Now, Paul was called by God. What was the calling of God? Look at what Paul, the commitment Paul made. On the day the Lord called him. What was the commitment? In Galatians chapter 1, verse 4, verse 14. Galatians chapter 1, verse 14. What did the Bible say? But when I saw that Galatians 1, verse 14. Look at what the scripture said. And profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in my own nation. Be more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers. But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace. Hallelujah. I say hallelujah. But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen. Immediately, I conferred not with flesh and blood. When it pleased God, Paul was deluded. He was deluded. He has delusion. He had a wrong theology. Wrong theology. Deadly theology. Deceitful theology, destructive theology, damnable heresies. And what was it? Look at it in verse 14. And profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in my own nation. He profited. He made progress. He was highly deluded. That's why salvation is by revelation. You may hear the word several years, you would have been born again. He was zealous. He rose up by rank among his equals and rose up and got to the highest height of any position religion could offer to him. Yet, wrong zeal, wrong direction. In delusion, he was in that delusion. He was and profited much and rose up to become a champion, championing that cause. Did he hear any other persecuted people like Paul? He did. Paul's delusion. He was deluded. Verily, he thought he was serving God until he met Christ. A man is religiously deluded until he has met with Christ. Morality cannot save. Sincerity cannot save. It's not enough. But Paul, until he met Christ, and he met Christ in Acts of the Apostles chapter 9, that day, there was a radical change. Oh, that day. I will never forget that day. I will never forget that day when Jesus washed my sins away. It is wonderful to know that Jesus died for me. My sins were washed away. My sins were washed away. Oh, what a glorious day. It is wonderful to know that Jesus died for me. Paul met Jesus. He met Christ. Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the brick. And he trembling and astonished said, Lord, what will thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the city. It shall be told thee what thou must do. And when Paul went, he went to Ananias and told Ananias, and the Lord said, behold, he prayed. So Paul was in that delusion until he met Christ. That day, radical change took place. His theology changed. His delusion changed. He cannot see the light. Paul, God has to blind him first. Have you been blinded by your own lifestyle? Has your theology been blinded? God has to blind his eyes to close him up to the old tradition and order to open up a new era for him. And from that day, he never remained the same. Paul the mentor, that's the mentor to be modeled. That is a model. A lot of people today say they are modeling. What are they modeling? Evil, immorality. Big Brother Niger. I don't even know what Big Brother Niger is all about. I don't even know. I don't even want to know. Modeling. And then they will do catwalk. Her eyes look like masquerade and that black witch. Like catwalk. What's catwalk? Catwalk. Cat are walking and they are kingdom. You want broad catwalk into human kingdom? Cat is a good animal. Catwalk. Then they're walking naked up and down. His theology changed. And then Paul took decision. Look at it. Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1. Paul took decision. Number one was Paul's delusion. Number two, Paul's decision. He got decided. And you will get decided today. I say you will get decided. Do you know what God wants to do to you today in this meeting, in this conference? God wants to make you a new man. You're living here a transformed person. I say you're living here a transformed person with a changed theology, with a changed experience. I say a changed experience. You won't be the same in Jesus' name. Paul's decision. Paul's decision. Galatians 1 verse 14. Look at it. And profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in my own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers. But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb, and called me by his grace to reveal his son in me, was the decision, I conferred not with flesh and blood. Immediately he became born again. He surrendered fully his life and service to God, and did much more better than those before him. Chapter 2 of Galatians, verse 8 and 9. Look at it. For he that wrote effectually in Peter to the apostleship of the circumcision, he said,
was mighty in me toward the Gentiles. And when James, Cephas, and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given unto me, they gave to me and Barnabas the right hands of fellowship, that we should go unto the heathen, and they unto the circumcision. Can you see? God began to deal with him. Mighty works were done by him, and the grace of God was upon him. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 10. Look at what the scripture says in chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians verse 10. That's what the scripture says. He said, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, but the grace of God, which was in me. He excelled. He excelled. The spirit of excellency came upon him. The spirit that conquers. The spirit that overcomes. The spirit that excelled, the power to excel was in him. He did his work diligently and he did successfully. He succeeded and he said, now I am ready to go to be offered. And I have finished my course. I have fought the fight of faith. I have kept the faith. Look at it. He said, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. I am what I am. God bestowed power upon him. Paul's decision, he did much more than any other person before him. What's his determination? Look at it. And this will be your passion, your drive. This is your drive. You know, some people say we want to get anointing. In this conference, they're not talking about anointing. They're not talking about power. I'm telling you, listen to this. Listen to this. There's no anointing more than this. No anointing more than what you are hearing here. That you should live a life that pleases God. That you should not cover your sin, the cost of covering sin. And that you should not be dishonest in small matter. You should not be dishonest in small matter. I remember when I was in the campus, we had a leadership meeting, and then we sent somebody to buy us chin chin, that's these bones, and then we gave him money. He bought the, he went and sold delay, that before he came, we bought more bones. And when he brought the bones, when he bought the bones, they gave him extra bones as jara. He took all the jara and ate them. By the time he arrived, we bought bones and we were eating, was satisfied. We said, take the bones back and collect our money. Hey. He stood calmly. Dishonesty is small matters. Bro. They have caught him. He had to open up. Because that time school have closed, people have gone home, no more money. Any person you see who is not in ITM, remaining in the school, has not transferred money. He's waiting for transfer money. And he was in that category, waiting. He ate at the jara. When he returned the bond, the woman will collect it, but he will count it. The two jara that she put on top, where are they? Abba, Mama. Give glory to God. You know, when Joshua, you can do some of these things in the place where nobody cares about little matters. And some people can say, but the temptation that happened on this place doesn't win. I'm not sure God is going to win. My friend in Sudan was giving some money to go to the mountain, and then he came back to give account of the money. And some little changes cannot account for me. The pastor, the one that told in South Africa, and I said, brother, go and find the money and complete this money and balance your account. The account must balance. They should not be miscellaneous. Some people still under miscellaneous. And you are having a conference like this, miscellaneous is giving out 100,000. You cannot have that. Miscellaneous is out of 100,000. Who is a miscellaneous? Who is a miscellaneous? This is a language of the people of the world who steal money in accounting offices. Say miscellaneous. What's miscellaneous? What did he do? And then the pastor told him, because we see us about holiness.
And while others are pursuing anointing, we're pursuing personal cleansing and holiness. Because that's what the anointing is. Anointing is a holiness. Don't pray for any power and gifts. Just concentrate on holiness. One day the power of God will break forth in your life. This is what God told me and I learned it. Pray for miracle, miracle. Don't bother. And I've seen the miracles in my life. Recently I saw the lame rising up to walk. I've seen it. When we don't even pray for it. When we don't even pray. We're not even expecting it to happen. My friend was telling me 2 days ago, a lady is classmate called him. Is it classmate or somebody in the called him? So the other one was attacked and the man became black and just here. And the old lady remembered him and called him. He said, bro, what are we doing? And see, my husband is black. And he spoke to them on the phone. They were just last 2 weeks. Spoke to them on the phone and tell the man, I am praying for you. I'm praying for you. That blindness will pass. As he held that phone and prayed. After that prayer, the man opened his eyes.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
And he was telling me, as we were discussing last 2 days, he said, brother, son, my brother, things to come. That's what we call as things to come. Because the vision for ministry was not to do with God. We said, greater things to come. We are expecting greater things. And greater things are coming. Because it has been our pursuit in life. Do you know sandstorm? How many of you have seen real sandstorm? Desert sandstorm. Sandstorm that if you lie down here, by the time that sandstorm comes and pass, you will know a human being is lying down here. The sand will bury you. I can't remember how many times we get buried like that in place of prayer. Sandstorm, if you see the weather, you would think heavy rain is coming. It's sandstorm from the desert. Wind is blowing sand. And when the place of prayer, I would say, what is sandstorm? I'm talking about the storm that moves vehicle, stationary vehicle, moves it away, Meduguri. And we have gone to pray. What are we praying for? Greater things to come. Ministry. I wasn't planning to practice vet medicine. Never in my life. He wasn't planning to practice biological science. Hey, where to fear call with biological science? We went hard. Our heart was hot. We want to see that this, we want to talk. Our dream and my dream till today is to turn the tide. We will turn the tide in this nation. We will turn the tide. We will talk, join hands with us. Give us time. Make environment convenient for us to preach this gospel. I'm telling you, you will see the stadiums getting filled. For your information, we are going to National Stadium. Wait. Wait. We have not prayed enough yet. When we hit that target and that threshold, you will see anointing. We went to pray and sandstorm was coming. I said, this will come. Don't you see? He said, this will come. What are you talking about? We will leave this place. We stayed there. All the wind, the dust, we drank dust. We lie down there. I'm talking about examination week. Exam was coming. We lie down there and pray. By the time we wanted to wake up, sandstorm was almost burying us. What are we looking for? Coach? I wasn't asking for coach. Money? No, never. Car? No. Marriage? No. And people would disturb me that time. Hey, Brother Sambo, who is your wife? Brother Sambo, we want to marry. They want to corrupt the woman before I marry her. And do mama over her. That's what they want to do. Is that the brother one? They want to corrupt the woman. I kept that. Nobody knew. Nobody knew. And then they will disturb me. One day, one of these mothers, you know, you have to respect them. You have to say you're married. giving. And as somebody, you know, because of the ministry, you need to pray, you know, the will of God, your marriage. Have you? She has so much disturbed me that I don't want to. Once she said, have you prayed to know the will of God in marriage? I say, yes. Ah, who is the sister? I say, her name is Revival and Holiness. That's my wife. She said, eh? I said, you don't know what you're talking about yet. You don't know what you're talking about yet. The will of God I have discovered now for me to marry now is revival and what? Holiness. Simple. End of story.
We were not asking for anything. And we are still not asking for anything. We are asking for revival. We want to turn the tide. We want to get the stadiums filled. Not with fake gospel. Not with adulterated gospel. But a true gospel of Jesus Christ. Christ the crucified and Him alone. Paul's determination. Philippians 3 verse 8. That is the true anointing. True anointing. Philippians 3 verse 8. Yea, doubtless, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ, my God, Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. Yea, do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. Yet doubtless, look at it. There's no doubt about this. Every iota of that have cleared them off. Do you know my pursuit? I am pursuing the excellency of the knowledge of Christ, by whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ and be found in Him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know Him, that I may know Him, that you may know Him. I say that you may know Him, that you may know Him, that you may know Him. And the reason and the power of His resurrection. Hi. May God find you tonight. May God find you tonight. I say, may God find you tonight, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His suffering. Hey, that I may know Him. That I may know Him. Which song are you singing now? He butter my bread. He sugar my tea. He carry Satan up. He knock him for ground one. They say, be beating Jesus. Is that the song you're singing? That's your song? You're not singing more about Jesus. More of His saving grace to know. You're not singing that I may know Him. And the power of His resurrection. And the fellowship of His suffering. That because of the pursuit, my determination to follow God. Paul said, yet doubtless, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. I want to win. And the person I want to win is who? Christ. The embodiment of the nature of God. The embodiment of the power of God. That's what I'm pursuing. That's my pursuit. In the morning, this song will sound only one life. I have a recorded of that song. 90 minutes. Those video can say 90 minutes. I play it in my... Normally, when school resumes, when school goes on break, long vacation, I don't go home. My dad is sick, I don't go home. Sometimes I stay 3 years before I come home. During break,
I stay in my room. Bible. 2 weeks, I don't step out except to urinate. That song, I play it 24/7. Only one life. We will sing this song. We will cry. We will shed tears. We will pray. We will read the Bible. My waking thought is only one life. My sleeping thought is only one life. As I'm waking up from sleep, the person is playing. As I sleep with it. As I wake up with it. As I sleep the next day, I wake up with it. 24/7 for 2-3 weeks. I'm playing that cassette every day. Every day. It is only one life. As I'm walking on the sea, it's only one life. It is only one life. God, I want to sacrifice this life back to you. That I may win Christ. Determination. That's Paul. He pursued after knowing Christ by forgetting those things that are past and moving forward to those things that are before him. That's Paul. His commission. Acts 26, verse 18. Acts 26, verse 18. Acts 26, verse 18. At midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven, above the brightness of the sun, shining round about me and all them, and them which journey with me. When we were falling to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me, saying in the Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And I said, Who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. Arise and stand upon thy feet. For I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister. To make thee a minister. To make thee a minister. And a witness both of these things which thou hast seen and of those things with the which I will yet appear unto. I will appear unto thee. Delivering thee from the people. And from the Gentiles, unto whom now I send thee, to open their eyes, and to turn them from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sin, and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Paul's commission. Number one, Paul as a preacher. Paul as a preacher. Acts chapter 20, verse 18 to 21. When they were come to him, he said unto them, Ye know from the first day that I came into Asia, after what manner I have been with you all at all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind, and with all many tears and temptations which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews, and how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but I shewed you and have taught you publicly, and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance towards God and faith towards our Lord Jesus Christ. Paul as a preacher, I keep back nothing. I will be faithful to you to keep back nothing from you. Paul kept nothing from the people. The rich and to the poor, he kept nothing from them. The same gospel that saved the rich, the same gospel saved the poor. The same gospel that saved the illiterate, the same gospel, the same power that saved the professor. The same gospel that saved, I have a friend, my friend is Sunday again, whom the other friend that side tried to persuade and turn him against me. Try with him, try with the wife, no way. And then later they manage me, hey, he's a friend to the rich, he's a friend to the rich. He only follows baby men, I knew that brother as a Christian before I ever knew he had business. I knew him as a brother first, as a preacher of the gospel first. Did not know he was in business. Did not know he had money. I didn't know. I first knew him as a Christian. I knew him as a preacher. It was recently I knew he has money and he has properties everywhere. And I did business. I didn't know. Same gospel. pastor that preached to the professor, he preached to the illiterate. He said it's a common grace, common salvation. Paul will not compromise the gospel because of a big man. No. He will not change his message because of somebody. He will change the content of the gospel. Good title, content zero. Good title of the message, content, nothing. Empty, no substance. And our brother here, our brother who is sitting here in the front, and sending people to my dad and saying, hey, that man is an evil man, an abortive man. When he was giving money to you, he didn't say it's a bottom man. When he leaves, it's a bottom man. You're changing face. You're not forthright. Same gospel. Same gospel. Paul will not change. Paul will not bulge. Paul will not change the content of his message. He won't pursue rich people. No. After sending me to pursue a particular person, then you turn again and say, I am the one pursuing rich people. You are evil. You are evil. A double face. Same gospel as a preacher. He preached repentance publicly from house to house. He preached to every category of people he met. Not compromising the gospel. Not changing it. Not lowering it. Not reducing the standard of the gospel. No. No. He stood firm. I gave back nothing that was profitable unto you. I preach the gospel fully to you. For the rich and the poor. For the white men and the black. I keep back nothing. I travel abroad, I don't keep anything back. I met the white, I tell them the truth. I met the black, I tell them the truth. I met the rich. In fact, sometimes the prison we put in place, the rich cannot buy us. We're to go to one rich man's house in the US, very rich. When I say rich, If you see the house, you say, why are people doing crazy things like this? The normal house of a normal human being in the US is nice. But when you go to that house and you see the courtyard and see the house, but I determined that as I'm going to do rich man's house, food, I won't eat there. I fasted. I also determined that if he gives me any money, I won't collect. End of story. Thank God he didn't offer money because he didn't have it. Because our food, I didn't eat. And the gospel was fully preached. Can you buy my conscience with money? How much euro are you going to give me? How much dollar are you going to give me to buy my conscience? To buy this gospel for me, to seal up my lips, that I will not tell you the truth. That who are you? That Paul will not preach the truth. That what's your name? Who born you? Do you have life to offer? Reward comes from God. And if you understand the reward comes from God, then there's no room for compromise. And if you are not a greedy minister, why will you compromise the gospel? Why will you preach terribly to the poor? When you come to the rich, you massage their ego. Our sister, the justice, the judicial legal fellowship between the Christian judges and the lawyer go to the mosque, go to church, and they want to go to the mosque. The FCC judicial, Christian body judicial, the bench and the bar had the legal to begin the legal year. And then she told them her son is a preacher and he's going to invite her son. They said, You were trying to invite him for this big meal. He said, no, I saw this man. And I came. The judges. You know, it's not easy to preach to judges. They are the most intelligent people in the world. And they will go in there. And I talked to them about eternity. It was as if you drop a pin, you will hear the sound. And we talk eternity. By the time we made up a call, you know, I didn't have a car at that time. And you are going to preach to judges who are filing it. By the time I quickly took taxes, the brother that when we made that time, we quickly took taxes and we arrived there in it. So we don't come with petty taxes. So that when they see come with petty taxes, they see this man is only looking for food. I put my suit, you know, I have a suit. I put my goose very, very well and package myself very well and put a thousand. We quickly arrived there and sat down and were waiting for them. By the time these judges started filing into the venue with their black jeeps and police orderly, I said, ah, we are here for trouble today. How can you talk to these people? But the word of God came. I so much prayed, because which grammar are you going to talk? Which scripture are you going to tell them? So much prayed that when I just climbed the pulpit and opened my mouth, Holy Ghost took over. By the time we made altar call, their hands were like this, giving their lives to the Lord. Mommy came out and hugged me and said, my son, you made me proud. It was actually God, not me. So, which gospel are you going to sell? The gospel is not for sale. Brother, it's not for sale. And some people think that we move up and down because we want to get money. No. No. Both abroad and home, when we travel, how much dollar did they give us? How much naira? How much naira did they give? Sometimes you go to a certain place where they even keep you. One of these places I went, you know, when you enter, we're going to talk about that tomorrow night. When you go to some of these places, not next tomorrow night, Jesus said, when you enter a place, don't go out again, stay there. Whatever condition you meet, they don't move. Don't go from house to house looking for a better place. No. The ground was not, there was no tile on the ground. There was not, they didn't plaster the wall. And the mattress was still the mattress on the floor. Oh! I lied on there. This is where God gave me assignment for this week. Not moving today. And the cold was coming out of the ground to my bones. Stay. No blanket. Stay. It's a test for you as a preacher. A test to overcome. And you end up spending so much money when you're even living. The pastor will not even come and say bye-bye to you. He doesn't need to say bye-bye to you, obviously. Because the person that called you is Christ. Not the pastor. Not the one that invited you. So, Paul, as a preacher, he preached repentance publicly. From house to house. Number two, Paul as a pioneer. He went to places where Christ was never been preached, has never been preached, has never been mentioned. He was a pioneer missionary. A pioneer missionary. A pioneer missionary. How many people? Some say, my anointing is not for village. Good luck to you. My anointing. When I'm entering the village, my anointing is going away. But as soon as I start entering, the anointing is falling like a dew. Oh, my brother. Go back to the cross. You've lost your color. Paul as a pioneer. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 14 to 16. What the scripture says. Chapter 14, verse 16. For we stretch not ourselves beyond our measure. For we stretch not ourselves beyond our measure. As though we reach out not unto you. For we are come as far as to you also in preaching the gospel of Christ, not boasting of things without our measure, that is, of other men's labor, but having hope, when your faith is increased, that we shall be enlarged by you according to your rule abundantly, to preach the gospel in the regions beyond you. And not to boast in another man's labor, line of things made ready for our land, to our hand. But he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. For not he that commended himself is approved, but whom the Lord commended. He went to places where Christ has never been preached. He was a pioneer missionary. Paul as a pattern. He was an example that others have to follow. He knew his calling, the sin, and stayed true to it. Paul knew his calling and stayed true to it. Lastly, Paul's consecration. Paul's personal consecration. He was not afraid, if need be, to die for Christ. He did not count his life so dear unto himself. He put his life on the line. He jeopardized his life. He counted it not so dear unto himself. And Paul, the man that had this cloak, when he entered the spirit of the kingdom, Paul said, I am even ready to do what? To go and die. For me to live is Christ. To die, I'm ready to die. Number two, Paul's purposeful consecration. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 19 to 23. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 19 to 23. 1 Corinthians 9, verse 19. For though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant unto all, that I might gain the more. And unto the Jews I became as a Jew, that I might gain the Jews. To them that are under the law, as under the law, that I might gain them that are under the law. To them that are without the law, as without the law, be not without law to God, but not under the law to Christ, that I might gain them that are without the law. To the weak became I as weak, that I might gain the weak. I have made all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. And this I do for the gospel's sake, that I might be partaker thereof with you. Know ye not that they which run all. These were purposeful consecration. He deliberately did it. Purposeful. He, with a purpose of heart, he deliberately consecrated himself. Purposefully, he determined to do it. And though it was tough and difficult, these are things he has to do personally to see that the gospel is not hindered. That the things he has to purposely do, to the weak I became as weak, to the strong I became as strong. I am made all things to all men, that I might by all means. This is not to say he compromised. No. Tradition, culture, he meandered around to reach out to the people. He maneuvered himself to reach out to the people. He adopted their culture to reach out, not simple culture, pure culture, to reach out to the people. He did all things to see how he can reach out to the people. He made himself all things to all men, that he might be able to save some. Paul's permanent consecration. Permanent. Number one, personal. Number two, purposeful consecration. Number three, permanent consecration. Everybody say it together with me. Permanent consecration. Paul's personal consecration. Say it. Number two, Paul's purposeful consecration. Say it. Lastly, Paul's permanent consecration. Galatians chapter 2, verse 18. Galatians 2, verse 18. For if I build again the things which I destroy, I make myself a transgressor. That's Paul. If I build again the things I have destroyed, if I preach on the pulpit
And when I get down from the pulpit to the pew, I destroy the message I have just preached. If I preach on the pulpit and get to the motor park and destroy my message by my character on the motor park, if I preach or have counseled somebody, and when I am weak, I return back to that lady that told me she was a prostitute, and she's still feeling some kind of temptation, and then I have counseled her, and then when I'm weak, when I'm tempted, then I give back and say, lady, come, because I know she's vulnerable. If I touch her here, she has told me everything, how men touch her, then she gets weak, she cannot do anything. Having had that, then after, when I'm tempted, I get back behind the pulpit, and then I talk to her, I say, as soon as she comes, I start touching her in the place she showed me. I make myself a confession. Pastor, God is not going to depend on me. If I build again the things I have destroyed, if I begin to go to members of the money, go to the church and borrow money from them, I've made myself a transgressor. I preach on sincerity and truth, and the church member found me lying. I go to visit sister, widow, or single mother. In the course of visitation, then I fell into fornication and say, God, we forgive all of us. Don't say anybody. I've made myself a transgressor. Paul's permanent consecration. If I borrow money and I don't pay, I borrow. Or I am in business with somebody and I don't pay. Or use the person's money and building house in my village, and then the person I'm owing, the person I don't pay. They collapse the business. He's not paid. I'm no more in business. Everything is collapsed. Oh, money is given to me on trust. And I don't have the money to pay. Pastor, what happened? You were giving money to store something trusted. And the money is with you. You did not buy the corn. You didn't buy the egusi. Where is the money? You have quickly gone and sold the item and have eaten up the money. Time to come to say the item, they call the money. No money, no egusi, no ginger. If I do again, the things I have destroyed, if I return to my vomit. Because you can do this other two consecration. If you fail in this, then you won't be able to say, for now I am ready to be offered. You can't say that. I have fought the good fight of faith. I have kept the faith. You can't say so. If I build again, the things I have destroyed, I make myself. I preach against divorce and remarriage. Now I have a problem with my wife, and then I contemplate to divorce and remarry. I make myself a transgressor. Sin is in your lips. Sin is in your court. If I do it again, the things I have, I was the one that destroyed them, and I build it again. I go away again, get the cement, get the wood, get everything. I said, let me reconstruct my former estate. Former estate.
You want to reconstruct your former estate.
If I build again the things I have destroyed, I make myself a transgressor.
My name will not be in the book of life.
We will look for you in heaven.
We won't find you.
I search heaven for you. Search vainly for heaven for you. Friends, won't you prepare to meet me up there? Search vainly for heaven for you. I have dreamt I had gone to the city. The city where never can die. I dreamt I searched heaven. I didn't find you.
You were not there.
Yes! You were. Your name was one there, but the angel said, come, Michael, let me show you.
This man built again the things he destroyed. He became a transgressor. And no transgressor shall have any part in the eternal life of God.
God is not playing. You are the one playing. God is not playing.
Where are you? I'm still waiting. Ministers of the gospel. I'm still waiting for you. Where are you? Where are you?
Lest we will search vainly
in heaven for you. We will search to heaven, we won't find you. And we will ask the angel, did you see that face we saw love? And they will say, that man wandered in darkness in his sin. He's somewhere in everlasting chain and darkness. He did not keep permanent consecration.
That's why he's here.
Are you praying? Those of us stand up in the back, join them to pray. Pray for yourself, brother. Can you be on your feet? Those of you, I mention your name. I love you so much. That's why I'm mentioning your name. Not as if you are not a Christian. No. Your faces are so loved. You shouldn't be found missing in heaven.
We should not search vainly to heaven for you.
Changing me.